Hi, Anirudh. Hello, am I audible?
Hello.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Hi, how are you?
Yeah, I'm fine, thank you.
Okay, so you got the timetable? I think that's the one, right?
Yeah, 26th, we have constitutional law.
Consti or contract?
Constitutional law.
Oh, I thought contract you have first. All right. Yeah, so good thing is that you have, I think first one is contract. Yeah, 26th you have contract, and then consti you have on 30th.
No, it's 26th constitutional law. I think that is for 5-year law or something on the first page. I think ours is on the 14th page of the syllabus or something. I don't know how that works. Our subject code is 4001, something like that.
Okay. All right, I was just checking.
I don't know why there are so many pages.
I got confused by saying this.
Exactly, even we all got confused. I don't know why there are so many pages over there. It's weird.
First semester on the 14th page. Okay, what is the code for constitution?
4001, like it's 4001 subject code.
Okay, subject code 4001. Yes, right. Oh, 26, you have constitution. Okay, this is the one. Why so many are there? I mean, examination 2018 onwards batch.
Exactly.
I was checking the first page.
And there is normal, there is repeater. We all of us actually first got confused, but then someone clarified it. I don't know like how they knew it.
But you have, taken admission this year only, right? I think first page is for you because they have mentioned 2021 examination. That one is 2018 and something. 14th page number is for.
I don't know if it's 14. The subject code should be 4001.
Okay. So confusing. I did not know you have subject code. Okay. Good then.
Okay.
Yeah, sure. All right. So
for the second year, third semester. For them, they have to write second semester, third semester together. Because of COVID, everything got postponed. And they are facing one more topic.
I think they may get a walkover. Yeah, 10, 12 subjects at a time, it's difficult.
10 subjects. If somebody has a backlog, then more than 10.
Yeah, for sure. Okay.
Yeah.
So, did you get this? You have something like study materials you get from college. Did you get that? Some PDFs you get
from college? No.
Yeah. From college, you should get.
Actually, we didn't get anything. I am using the Usha Jagannath series.
Okay. All right.
It's a guidebook. This is for contract, so I only have that. And there is some other study material that someone else forwarded, but that is something else, some law academy, something else. I don't know what that is. It also doesn't cover our syllabus exactly. It has many elements of it.
Some PDFs are there, but if you are reading the topics in general, you don't need to refer to those as such. Okay, so we will...
I don't mind either ways. I just want to pass. It's like our passing is 32 marks we have to score.
Yeah. No worries. 32 is not that like a number. All right. So you were concerned about, you know, like how you will prepare everything in such a short span of time. So one thing is that if you look at the question papers, right, it's all like subjective type question, right? So it's not like they are asking you directly what is preamble, what's there in preamble, write that for 2 marks. It's not like that. You can elaborate things when you have subjective type questions like 10 marks, 15 marks. You can write some background, some detail, whatever you know. Okay.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
First thing you should consider for all the different subjects is that you can prepare with one basic introduction. All right. That will fit any answer that you are writing.
Oh, okay.
So now how you will prepare one basic introduction which should fit any question no matter what they are asking for 5 different units. For that, take for example, you are studying contracts, right? You can write or read something about the Indian Contract Act. That Indian Contract Act is what it is providing for general principles as well as specific contracts, this, that, like that you can refer, okay? I'll give you that also. So that will help you have a, you know, like a very good introduction to all of your questions. And it will also increase in number of pages. Like I told you, pages matter a lot in these cases.
Yeah.
Same thing, you can apply for constitution as well, that you can know some basic details about Indian constitution, which you can write for any answer, no matter what they are asking in the question paper. So you can start with your basic introduction, then whatever topic they are asking. All right, so it's important that we know some basic things about constitution.
But what if from one unit they ask 2 questions? Can I write the same intro for both of them?
No, not same intro. That's what I'm telling you. You need to prepare like a big intro from there. One part you are writing for one answer, another part you are writing for another. Like that you prepare. Same intro if you are writing, it would be like not good, right? So what is constitution and the basic background? From there you can pick up certain lines and that you can put your introduction. All right, so have you read anything about the constitution? Any idea what all things are there? What is it?
Yeah, I've read the first unit and all. I've read the first unit for the internals. I've prepared for it. And the assignment and all I've read about it, like the preamble of the constitution and essentials of constitution, things like that.
Okay. So what is there in the preamble? What is basically preamble?
Preamble is like the, introduction or something like, I have to actually revise. I read it for my internals.
Yeah, so it's like an introduction to constitution.
Introduction to any document, in this case, the constitution.
Yeah.
So it's like that. And what is constitutionalism, features of constitutionalism, all those things. I had to read from internals.
Yeah. Okay, so with regard to this, right, you can read a little bit about the background also. Those things can be written in your introduction for any question for that matter. So what is constitution first of all? Constitution is like a supreme law of land in India. Now, when we say supreme law, what is supreme law? We know that there is Supreme Court. That means it's like the highest court, right? Similarly, when we say supreme law of land, that means whatever laws are there in India, it's supreme. All right. It's on top of all the other laws that we have in India. Okay. That means whatever is written in constitution, we need to follow that no matter what. And after that, only all the other laws will come. Okay. So even courts have a power that if any law is violating any provision of constitution, higher courts can declare that law as unconstitutional, that law as invalid. That law will no longer be applicable in India. Why? It's only because constitution is supreme law. No matter what, we should follow constitution, whatever is mentioned there. So first of all, for anything you can go with this thing that constitution is the supreme law of land in India, and any other laws, regulations, rules, whatever is there, it should follow the provisions mentioned under constitution. That's the first thing that you can remember. Next, okay, fine, constitution is supreme law, but what is it that is there inside the constitution? What all things do we have inside constitution?
Constitution has it guarantees it lays out everything, all the laws to be followed, guarantees rights, protections, and those things.
Yeah,
and
so
it declares that that's what it guarantees, rights, freedoms, and how basically the country should be governed, the powers and duties of the elected representatives, judges, and directive principles of state policy, those things.
Yes. Yeah. So first of all, it provides for fundamental political code, how we will be governed, right? In case of central government, in case of states, union territories, for all of those, it provides for the hierarchy as well, right? Who all will be the people, what will be their offices, designation, appointment, qualification, all the things, fundamental political code, basic things that we need to know. Apart from that, we would have different legislations providing detailed provisions. If there is constitution, it may tell us that, okay, these are the members of parliament, these are their basic powers, privileges, etc. Then we can have detailed laws. In detail, they are mentioning the powers and functions, privileges, whatever is it. So first of all, it provides for a fundamental political code. It provides for fundamental rights as well, right? We would have certain rights which are like fundamental, no matter what, these rights will be guaranteed, except for certain exceptions. Then we have directive principles. These are like the guiding principles for the government. Government would follow or refer to these principles wherever needed, as well as duties to citizens. Like you told, with regard to judges and all, also it has elaborate provisions, right? With regard to emergency, it has detailed provisions. So a lot of things, the basic things that we would need, everything is mentioned in brief. But again, we may have elaborate legislations explaining any of those matters again, right? So it's the supreme law of land providing for all these details. You can, you know, like study this thing, and in any kind of introduction, you can put these words, that what is constitution. If there is a question with regard to fundamental features of constitution of India, you can go with an introduction. What is constitution? What is it that constitution is providing? Then you can maybe mention the features, right? So these things are something which you can make use of in any answer that is there that you want to write. Next, you should know with regard to framing of the constitution. So this part is not that important. You can just go. Okay. So Constitution of India was framed by something called as a Constituent Assembly. All right. And it was set up under Cabinet Mission Plan of 1946. So you can try to remember this part. It just will give strength to your question. So you can write, there is something called as Cabinet Mission Plan that we read in our history classes in school. What is Cabinet Mission Plan? Basically, British left India all of a sudden, right? So everything was governed by them. They were taking care of everything. All of a sudden, if all the powers are given to Indian leadership, it's not possible for them to handle everything, right? So we needed a plan, how powers will be transferred, how it will happen and everything. So those things were mentioned in this document called Cabinet Mission Plan. And under that document only, Constituent Assembly was set up. So Constituent Assembly is what? It consists of 22 different committees. There were 22 different committees formed to deal with different matters. Now, as you told, it is telling about judges, then powers of all the different body, government officers, fundamental rights, DPSP, and whatnot. It's not possible for one individual to know about every single thing, right? Yeah. So that is the reason why 22 different committees were formed, that there will be different matters that we will have under constitution. So one body would just concentrate on one single matter And ultimately, they would just prepare documents with regard to that specific matter. And finally, we would just club all of those together and prepare one single document called as constitution. So that is the reason why we had 22 different committees dealing with different matters. And ultimately, they had to submit a report based on whatever they researched during that specific time frame. So you can remember this part as well.
So each committee set up, they wrote certain parts of the constitution and then the whole thing was merged then.
Yeah, you can say in a way, but not like they wrote it. They submitted reports based on those, mm-hmm. those reports. Ultimately, it was drafting committee who compiled everything and then prepared the document. It's not like I am writing part one, you write part two, those two things we will decide together. We are just submitting documents. Drafting committee ultimately decided what all we will be putting. So there were these 22 committees and accordingly they did this. So committee's name and all you may not remember, those are not that important. So on the basis of whatever reports were submitted by these 22 different committees, constitution was prepared by a 7 members drafting committee. So there was this committee of 7 members, which was drafting committee. So basically they had to draft a constitution based on whatever reports they received. And it was headed by Chairman Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Mm-hmm. So how good are you in remembering numbers?
I'm okay.
Okay. So then you can remember that initially, okay, this part is important, all right. Initially, Constitution of India had different article schedules. So do you know what are article schedules and parts in the Constitution?
Articles mean article number so and so of the constitution will state one law, and then each article I think has one section under its section, this thing of article so and so states. So
okay, so sections are for different legislations that we have. We do not have sections under constitution, we just have articles. Okay, articles are for constitution, sections are for any legislation that you read, maybe Indian Contract Act, IPC, there you will get sections. There you won't get articles. Once again, I'll just open the BARE Act. And for any provision that you want to see, you can always refer to the BARE Act, which would have the most genuine information. And from there, you can just refer. So have you ever seen the BARE Act of Constitution?
No.
Okay. So what is BARE Act basically?
What is this BARE Act?
Yeah, B-A-R-E, BARE Act.
B-A-R-E, BARA.
B-A-R-E.
Okay, no, I haven't seen this.
Okay, so BARE Act basically means from Parliament, a basic bare document would come, right? That document is called as BARE Act. So from Constituent Assembly, Constitution is coming. That is BARE Act. If I'm writing a book, elaborating any provision of Constitution, that becomes a book. Why? Because I am explaining it in my own words. I'm giving my opinion there. So that becomes a book. BARE Act is the basic document without any comments, anything. Whatever came from Parliament or whatever it is, right? That is BARE Act. So if you look at the BARE Act of Constitution, okay, not this one, which has content, I will see that. So for Constitution as well, you can... All right, so this is the BARE Act of Constitution where we will see different provisions also. So for legislations, we have sections. For Constitution, we have articles, okay? Okay, I'll just open from here only. So Constitution of India is divided into something called as articles. Then we have parts and as well as we have schedules, different schedules we have. So you need to remember this thing if you can. It's important, okay? You can mention this somewhere in your answer as well. So initially at the time when Constitution came into force, right? We had 22 different parts. We had 12 schedules and 395 articles. But then we know, right, there are different amendments that may be done, right? If we feel that this provision is not working, we need to bring a new provision, we can make changes in the Constitution. So those are called as amendments, that we are making some changes. So by way of making all those amendments or changes, as of now, we have 448 articles. Initially, we had 395. Now it has come to 448 articles. From 22, now it's 25 parts. From 8 schedules, now it has become 12 schedules. Try to remember these numbers if you can.
Okay, so initially it had, initially Constitution had these many, like first when it was drafted.
Yeah. Not drafted, when it was accepted. After drafting also, there were many debates and everything. So when it was accepted that this is what we are accepting as Constitution, at that time, this was the number.
8 schedules, okay.
Yeah. And as of now, we have these many.
Eight articles, 25 parts.
448 articles, 25 parts, 12 schedules.
448 and 12 schedules.
Yeah. So now we should know what is articles, parts, schedules. Why do we need three different things in one single constitution, right? So if you look at the constitution, this is the bare act, okay? Without any comments of anyone, without any explanation or anything, just the bare document which we received. Okay. So if you see, there are different parts. These are parts. Part one, part two. What are parts basically? Part means one single area. Okay. There are different topics or different matters that Constitution is dealing with. So one single matter is mentioned under one single part. All right. If I'm saying it is with regard to fundamental rights. So fundamental rights will be mentioned under one single part only. We are not putting it here and there. All right. Everything is there in one single part. Similarly, whatever provisions are there relating to citizenship, they are in one single part. DPSP is one single part. With regard to union, one single part. So part basically means one single topic that Constitution of India is dealing with.
Okay.
Okay. Now there are different topics that Constitution is dealing with. So that is the reason we have 25 different parts.
Okay, 25 different parts.
Yeah. Okay. Now, under parts also, it's not just one single right that Constitution is providing, right? There are too many different rights. So all of these different rights will be provided under different things, right? So that is what is called as article. One single article will deal with one single provision or two or three different provisions, related provisions basically, right? Similarly, like we write in one paragraph, one single matter, next paragraph we write, right? Same, like that only articles we have where one single provisions are mentioned. So that is the reason inside parts we have articles. And that is the reason number of articles are also more, 448 articles in total. All right, next thing is schedules. Now parts are there, articles are there. Okay, fine, what is schedules? But schedules basically mean for any matter, okay? If they are explaining about what is union, what are states, union territories in India, maybe I do not know how many states are there in India. I do not know how many union territories are there in India, or I do not know what is the territory of each of the states that we have. If I'm reading any provision that, okay, fine, India, this is what is a state. If I do not even know how many states are there in India, what is the territory of those states? It's not possible for me to understand that topic in detail, right? So I would need to know how many states are there. For that matter, I can refer to the schedules that we have. Okay, so first schedule, if you see, first schedule is dealing with states and union territories. So that means schedules are giving some essential information, some additional information that we may need to refer. But there may be five different articles inside Constitution which are talking about state. Every time they would not provide us a list of all the 29 states and union territories which we have. But you refer to first schedule if you want, right? Similarly, we have provisions with regard to oath and affirmation taken by president, governor, and all of that. They are privileges, immunities, whatever benefits they would get, right? Many other things are there in schedule. So schedules would basically mean some additional information that will help you understand any of the articles or parts in a better way. All right, so these are the three things which we have under Constitution. Is it clear?
Yeah. So in a Constitution, there are parts. Each part deals with one aspect, like citizenship, union territory, powers and functions. And inside each part, there will be articles like, okay, article number so and so will say the, all this. And then schedule means it will just tell that what is a state, what is a union territory. It's like definitions.
Not definition as such. It's like additional information. If I'm telling you how many states are there, what is the territory of each of those states, that is additional information which I'm giving you. So schedules are like additional information which you may need to refer, you may not. If you need to refer at all, you go to the schedules and see. I'm not telling you again and again in each of the articles basically. All right. So now if you see, as of now, we have 448 articles. Okay. But in the BED Act, if you see, what is the last number of article? It's still 395. So why so? If there are 448 articles, why is the last number of articles still 395?
Repeals, it says repeal. So
repeal isn't like it was there, then later on it was like said that it will not be applicable, but still last one is 395, right? But we just now read it's 448. So why so?
Are there subdivisions under each article, like article
yeah, somehow like that only. If I'm saying that there are different parts talking about different things, if there is part 3, which is providing for fundamental rights, or part 4 providing for DPSP, maybe you want to bring a certain thing in part 4. So you don't need to add it as 396 number article, but you can insert it over here, just like this one, article 339A. All right. So whenever you are seeing A, B, C, or any alphabet for that matter, that means originally it was not there. Later on, it was inserted.
Okay.
Okay. Just like articles, so total, parts.
So total number of articles are 448.
Yeah.
But only 395 main articles are there, and under some of them, there is A, B, C subparts.
No, like these are not subparts, because this is 39 and this one is another article. It's not subpart, but they are added, because after 39, obviously 40 only will come. So how will you insert another article? That is why they have mentioned A. But this A is in caps. Okay. So that means it's not subpart. If it is in small A, that means it's subpart. Okay. So
but does 39, are 39 and 39A related, like not, related to the same thing?
No, 39 and 39A are not related, but all of these are related to part 4. That is why it is inserted. Equal justice and free legal aid is related to part 4. That is why they have inserted it here. All right.
Okay.
So that is why if you count all these A, B, C, D and everything, then it would become 448. And just like articles, even in case of parts also, we can make additions. Like we felt that fundamental duties should be there here only. So we mentioned part 4A. All right. We can do whatever we want, whatever we want to insert, we can do that basically. So this number, you try to remember total number of articles, parts, schedules. Okay. Now there are two more important dates. If you are finding it difficult, you can just remember this part. What is the total number as of now? This part you can skip. Okay, next important thing is when Constitution of India was adopted and when it came into force. Now, what is the difference between these two dates? For one single document, why do we have two different dates, adoption and came into force?
Came into force means from 26 Jan 1950, it became the official law. Like from that date, this law, this set of laws started being followed.
Yeah. And adopted
would be, I think, was it like formally accepted that, okay, this is right. This is right. This is the constitution. Now, okay, we'll confirm this. Like, was that like a confirmation?
Yes. Right. It was like a confirmation that we adopted, we accepted that, okay, this is what we are going to follow as our constitution, right? So that date is what? 26th of November, 1949. All right. 26th of November, 1949. Try to remember this date. If there is a question at all that write something about Constitution of India, you can write these things that Constitution of India was adopted on 26th of November, 1949. And this particular date is celebrated as Constitution Day or National Law Day.
Okay, okay.
All right. So you can remember this part also. It's important that it was adopted on this particular date, 26th of November, 1949.
It's called as Constitution Day or Law Day?
National Law Day.
National Law Day.
Yeah.
And now, this is Republic
Day. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, Republic Day. So now we accepted that this is going to be Constitution, but like all of a sudden we cannot just accept a thing. We may need to make certain arrangements and all the other stuff, right? So for that, a certain duration is given. Usually you would see for any legislation, there would be two dates, adoption as well as came into force, enforcement date. Same happened with Constitution. Also, we had some time to make all the necessary arrangement that we needed. So it was 26th of January 1950 from when it became applicable. That whatever is mentioned in Constitution, we need to abide by that. We need to follow that. Okay. Yeah, so from this, whatever we read, right, this is what is important, important things to remember. Constitution of India was framed by a constituent assembly, which was set up by the cabinet mission plan. Total number of articles initially, 22 parts, 395 articles, 8 schedules. Even if you do not remember this part, it's fine. You can remember this. Total number of articles, schedules and parts as of now. 448 articles, 25 parts, 12 schedules. Then we have two different dates to remember. When it was adopted, 26th of November 1949, celebrated as Constitution Day or National Law Day. Another one, when it came into force, 26th of January 1950, celebrated as Republic Day.
Okay. Right? Yeah.
Now, if there is a question with regard to maybe features of Constitution or write something about preamble or write about Constitution in general, you can write these things, right? Because they are not limiting you that you write only this part. You can write these things also when it came into force and all this stuff. So you can remember this part. I'll share this document anyways with you so you can go through this. Now, with regard to salient features. So if you have seen the question paper, you must have seen there are questions regarding the features of Constitution.
Salient features is one of the important
most common question. Yeah. So can you name any of the features of Indian Constitution?
Features like salient features. I think I have to revise again because I read it like 3 weeks back and since then I've been doing. Now I remember it's the lengthiest one. It's taken from different sources. Now I'm remembering.
Okay. 1 second. Huh? My battery is dying. I'll just bring my charger.
Yeah.
All right. So there are many features. All right. So these are the important ones that I have picked up. So you can study from here only. Now, what is lengthiest written constitution? Is there something called as unwritten constitution? Do we have something called as unwritten constitution?
No.
Now see, for laws, right?
No, one country, like constitution has to be written, like.
Okay. So see, for constitution, right? One country will have one constitution only. Okay. But for other laws, we can have multiple different laws. Okay. India will not have two constitutions or three constitutions, but India has thousands of legislations, you name it. Okay. So first feature is that it is one of the lengthiest written constitutions in the world. Now, there are countries which do not have a codified constitution. Codified as in means written proper document. If you want to know whether a certain thing is there in constitution or not, you can simply refer to the BEREC that I showed you right now. Right? You can just simply see whether a certain thing is there or not there. It's as clear as that. But for certain countries, they do not have a codified constitution. That means they do not have one single document called as constitution. There can be different provisions written in some documents. There can be different case laws, certain things here and there. It's all scattered. All right, that they would follow. Might be there are provisions, but they are all scattered in different places. They will follow that. That means they do not have a codified proper written constitution like we have. So these are some of such countries. But in case of India, we have the lengthiest and longest constitution in the world, which is having 448 articles, 25 parts and 12 schedules. All right. If you want to elaborate on this, if there is a question regarding salient features, if you just remember five features in exam hall, it's fine. You elaborate on this. You write that, okay, fine. What are articles? Articles are providing for, there are different parts. Constitution talks about citizenship, fundamental rights, this, that, whatever you know, you just write it. All right. Because you are not just limited. You can write whatever you want under this provision, lengthiest written constitution. Okay, next thing is drawn from different sources. Now, what is drawn from different sources?
Okay, like from the UK's constitution, from America's constitution, and some basically from different countries. Countries' constitutions, we've taken certain parts like, like fundamental rights or power and functions of public servants and contracts and these kind of things.
Yeah. So just like in
case of these kind of things from different countries.
So just like in case of movies and all, like Bollywood is not just something that originated in their brains, right? They have taken inspirations from some foreign movies also that they have tried to make in India, right? Same happened with constitution also. So certain things that were already existing in other countries' constitution and that were doing good, we tried to pick up those things. But it's not like exact copy-paste we are doing. We tried to take the concept and whenever or wherever needed, we tried to modify it a little bit, then applied in India. All right. So in case of India, most of its sources are borrowed from different countries' constitutions where it was already doing good. I have also made a list in case if you are interested to read about it or you want to remember, you can just read one or two examples also you can give, like this one is borrowed from this constitution, you can refer to that. So Indian constitution is not like the original piece of document, but its concepts were borrowed from other foreign countries as well. Next is single constitution for both union and state. We know there is union government, there are state governments, right? But state governments do not have constitution for their own. We do not have a constitution for Karnataka, right? So it's one constitution for union, which will be applicable to states as well. So India has a single constitution that will be applicable both for union as well as the states. And it will promote unity and will provide these that you can just elaborate, okay? Single constitution empowers parliament to make changes in constitution. If it's like states are having constitution, it's difficult, right? Becomes difficult to make changes in everything. If it's one, it's better. All right, so we have one single constitution. Next is secular character. What is it?
Secular character. Okay, like all religions are equal and does not have one national religion.
Yes.
And everyone has freedom to practice any religion they want.
Yes. So under articles, under constitution, we have these articles 25 to 28, right? 25, 26, 27, 28. It provides us freedom to practice, profess, propagate any religion of our choice. We are not restricted. Just because we have these provisions, our constitution is providing for a secular state where government is not supporting or promoting one single religion, but they should not discriminate. All the religions will be equal. We do not have a national religion or something like that. So if you can remember, you can also mention that these are, we have something called as freedom of religion under fundamental rights. So that makes India a secular state. That also you can maybe write. Next is federalism in India. What is federalism?
I think like center and state governments are divided. Yes. Like there is.
Yeah.
So.
Right. So union means union government, one single government. But in India, we have a federal structure of government. That means we will have central government as well as we will have different state governments. So that states can take decision on certain matter. They can function well, like an independent body. So in India, we have federalism. That means division of power is there between union as well as the states. Certain matters, union is having power. Certain matters, states are given power, like police, electricity. Then there are matters where states are given power. So with regard to that, we have different lists also. Right. If you remember your political science classes from school or somewhere, we had this thing, right? That we have union list where there are 100 items. Items basically mean the areas where they can make laws. So there are 100 items where union would make laws, like maybe banking, then there can be railways, right? Then union public service, like that. Then we have state list, 61 subjects where states would make laws. Then we have something called as concurrent list, where it's not divided between union or state. It would be jointly they would make certain decisions, right? So we have three different lists also that tells us that in India, we have federal structure of government. Powers are divided between union as well as the states. Next is parliamentary form of government. So in India, we have a parliament, we know, right? So that is why it is called as a parliamentary form of government. Now, India has a bicameral legislature. We have two houses in parliament, right? We have Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. That part you can explain. So we have two houses. And Government of India Act 1919 introduced this concept of bicameral legislature at the center for the first time. That at center also in parliament also we can have two houses, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. So that part you can explain. Citizenship. We have single citizenship, right? Even though powers are given to states, states cannot give citizenship, right? I cannot be a citizen of Karnataka, then a citizen of India, but it's only one citizenship. So you can also write that single citizenship promotes a, you know, like feeling of unity and brotherhood. That also you can mention or you can elaborate. Directive principles of state policy. They are mentioned under part 4 and articles are 36 to 51. What are DPSPs? These are basically some guiding principles that government will keep in mind while framing a law, while bringing a certain scheme, they will keep these principles in mind, right? These are basically some like mission or some vision that government wants to achieve at a certain time. So these are directive principles of state policy that government would keep in their mind while framing laws, while bringing certain schemes, legislations, whatever. Next is fundamental. See, in case you do not recall the features in exam hall, right? You just remember what are there in constitution. Whatever you remember, you frame a feature with that. if you remember, okay, fine, there is something called as fundamental right, you write it that Indian constitution provides for fundamental rights to citizen. These are guaranteed rights. We can enforce it in court of law. We can directly go to Supreme Court. These are different mm-hmm. types of whatever you know, just write it.
Mm-hmm.
Similarly, we have fundamental duties. So fundamental duties were originally not there in constitution, but it was by 42nd amendment that these were inserted. So this part is called as part 4A. That means originally it was not there, right? Whenever we see A. So it was accordingly inserted. Total, we have 11 fundamental duties. All right. Next feature is emergency provisions. So under constitution, president is empowered to take certain steps, right? To tackle extraordinary situations. Normal situations, it's mentioned, union as well as center. But sometimes situations may become so complicated that it's not possible for the government to act or to function like a normal situation, right? In such cases, president is given this power to declare emergency. So there are three different types of emergencies, national, state, as well as financial emergency. So these are few of the features, okay? These are like 10 important features that you can go through this document, all right? And try to read it. And then these are some concepts that we anyways keep on listening, right? You can just elaborate on these points.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the document that is there with regard to features borrowed. So from which country, what features are borrowed? There can be two, three different features. Apart from different countries, Government of India Act, from there also certain concepts were borrowed. All right. So before Constitution, this Government of India Act was applicable in India. All right. Then considering these questions, right, it's not important for you. So skip this part. Questions are not important. Other things, you can go through this document. All right. So is it clear? This part?
Yeah.
Okay. So what are you planning? Like, you will be reading these, trying to memorize, or you are able to write like main things you can remember and then you would be able to frame answers? What are you planning for your exams?
No, obviously, like all units, everything I won't be able to finish. So I feel main... the important, most repeated questions, I'll go with that, and that I'll try to understand. After understanding, before one day before the exam, if I revise it, I'll remember. No, like without understanding blindly, one day before the exam, if I start reading,
yeah,
be difficult.
Okay.
So I guess that will be better. Like important questions from all units. So, yeah, I think we had like 10 questions of 10 marks each. Out of that, I think 6 we have to answer. And then we have 6 questions of 5 marks each. Yeah, 6 questions of 5 marks each. That I think out of 6, any 5 we have to answer. So 6 5s are 30, 10 5s are 50, 30 plus... 50-80, so it's like that.
Okay.
So I think, so in that 6 questions of 5 marks, I think their short answers or problems, like they will give one, A did this, B did this, so how will you argue like that, case problem, like.
Yes. So one thing is that, you know, like, just I will read the important things or I just need 30 marks, that thing you just... you know, like keep it aside, okay? Whatever we are discussing in class, right? Try to listen to that carefully. After the class, I'll share this document, okay? What you can do is immediately, that same day, you can download this document. Whatever is not necessary, that part you erase it, all right? Just like from this one. I told you that whatever is important, I discussed. I did not discuss this part, right? You erase this. These images, you erase it, all right?
Yeah.
Then... these names of committees not needed. Erase this part, all right? Yeah. Whatever is needed, important, that part you just keep it. If you want to make some additional pointers or something for your understanding, you do that. Whatever you want to do with this document, right? You do that same day so that you remember those things. And then you can just read the document one more time. it will stay fresh in your mind. Okay, next day, whatever we are discussing, same, you just read that. If you know the concept, right, you can answer the question. Do not read the question and then prepare for the question only. Try to read the concept. After that, you will be able to frame your answers. So whatever is important from this part, you just read it. I'll give this document to you. You go through this document. You try to memorize this important dates and everything. If you know that whatever question they are asking does not matter, you will answer it anyways, right? So that part you focus on, not the questions. After finishing the subject, we will discuss the questions. But now do not focus on questions much. Just try to read these things, okay? All right. So this is about the features of Indian Constitution. Next thing that we have is with regard to preamble, all right? That also is an important part of Constitution. Preamble, yeah. Yeah, preamble is again very important. So for that also, we have this thing. So this is the entire Constitution. But again, you do not need the entire Constitution. So this much we used to read in one semester only. You just have few things. So you can read it in these many days as well. So do not focus on that. We will discuss one by one, and accordingly, you keep on preparing at the same time for this. Okay. When we are finishing Constitution, we will go through the questions. When we are finishing the other subject, we will go through the questions. So no need to worry about that. Okay. So for today, you can do one thing. You can go through this document. You can read it. Try to remember the important dates, numbers, whatever is there. All right. And in next class, we will start with preamble, and then accordingly, we will move with the topics. You similarly start preparing yourself also. Okay. So,
yeah. Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So,
But as and when like days are moving forward, I think we'll have to like more. Like, I don't think we may not be able to complete 5 units. Correct. No.
No, we will be. See, like actually, no, I have some presentation on 19th. So that is the reason why I need to prepare today and tomorrow. But after that, I'm free. Okay, so we can take 2 hours classes where we would discuss a lot of things. You prepare that same day. So that way we can complete it. No worries about that. Okay. For today and tomorrow, you can prepare other subjects that you have. Maybe from 19, we will have 2 hours classes. We will complete lot of the.
Okay. So next class tomorrow or
19th. Okay. Today and tomorrow, actually, I'm a little busy with the presentation. From 19th, we will have 2 hours classes.
Okay. Fine.
So I'll share this document. You can just start preparing yourself. Yeah. Okay then. Yeah. Fine. Thank you. Yeah.